begin in a few minutes.
So is it full screen or?
Yeah, I can see it. I'm not full screen, but I can see it.
Okay, let me make it.
It froze for me.
Okay, so.
Yeah, now it's proceeding full screen, right?
So
x square, summation 1 by n x square is finite. Okay? So, if this cn, this is anyway controllable.
Oh, wait a second.
If this cn...
we are getting some other sound.
Shashi Mohan's talk is coming along.
No, okay, fine. So, now you're okay. So we can begin. So it's a great pleasure to introduce Shanta Laishram, who is a professor in Indian Statistical Institute, Delhi. And he's a student of T.N. Shori. He got his PhD from TIFR in 2004, which makes him Edosh number two. And he has already got more than 30 collaborators and more than 40 publications. So he will be speaking on a conjecture of Erdős on squares in arithmetic progression.
Okay, yes. Yeah, thank you, Gaurav, for your introduction. And yeah, I have to thank Ashoka for this opportunity. And yeah, so today I'm going to speak on some results, which is combination of old and new work. So basically, in earlier time, around my PhD times and bit afterwards, I work on this conjecture of Erdős, and recently there was some recent work, so I'm going to combine both of them. So I'll give an introduction to this problem and try to go a bit slow. So basically, the problem is quite simple to state. So we're interested in finding this squares in arithmetic progression. So you look at this arithmetic progression n plus t n plus 2t n plus k minus 1d. So it's a k-term arithmetic progression, and you're asking, can you find an arithmetic progression consisting of all the squares? So n is a square, n plus t is a square, etc. Now clearly, of course, if k is one, just one term is trivial. Even for k equal to 2, two-term arithmetic progression, you can actually find infinitely many. So you can take n to be any a square, and you take d such that n plus d is some b square. So you can have infinitely many squares, two squares in arithmetic progression. So even for the case 3, so one can actually cook off three-term arithmetic progressions, which are all squares. So you start with R and S positive integers, which are of opposite parity. That means R is odd, S is even, or vice versa. And R and S is co-prime. So if you take N to be R square minus S square minus 2RS. Yeah, so if you take n to be r square minus s square minus 2rs whole square, and d to be 4rs times r square minus s square, then you can see that n is a square, n plus d is square of r square plus s square, then n plus 2d is also a square. So in fact, you can also have infinitely many three-term AP, which are all squares. Now, can you go further? So that's the thing. And the bug stops here in the sense that Fermat proved that you cannot have four squares which are all in arithmetic progression. So basically, if you have n plus d, n plus 2d squares, then n plus 3d cannot be square. You cannot have four squares in arithmetic progression. And Euler, like many, he generalized many of Fermat's results. So one, in this case also, he generalized this result of Fermat by showing that if you not only four square, you cannot have four squares in arithmetic progression. If you multiply four consecutive terms of an arithmetic progression, it can never be a square. Yeah. So counting squares stops here, but then asking whether a product of terms become a square starts here. So here I want to consider these two questions. The first question is that can you have a product of four or more consecutive terms of an arithmetic progression being a perfect, can a product of four or consecutive terms of an arithmetic progression be a perfect square? And so not only that, we can ask, so if you're given an arithmetic progression of n terms, how many squares do you expect? So these two questions I want to discuss in this talk. So regarding the first question, so this is a result of mine with Hirata Kono, Soren Tideman in 2006, that if you have like four terms, five terms, six terms, or 209 terms, you cannot have so 4k lying in this interval 4 to 109, the product of any k consecutive terms of an arithmetic progression is never a square. So this is a generalization of Euler's result. So from 4 we went up to 109. In fact, independently, this when k like five terms, between 5 times to 11 terms, it was also done by Bennett, Bruin, Jory, and Haidu. So this is on the product of k consecutive terms of an arithmetic progression. So basically, the theorem which I stated gives a partial answer to the following open problem. So the open problem is that if you take product of four more consecutive terms of an arithmetic progression, it's never a square. So we know that up to 109, I mean, terms, it can be a square, but more than 109, it's still open. So this is related to a conjecture of errors. So I'm going to state the conjecture of errors. So for, to do that, let me give some notations. Let's take n, d, k be positive integers. I'm going to take k bigger than or equal to 4, and GCD of n and d to be 1. So I'm going to take product of k consecutive terms, so n, n plus d, n plus 2d. I'm going to denote by delta n, dk. So that means n is the first term, d is the common difference, k is the number of terms. And define for the p of n positive integer to be the maximum prime divisor. For instance, p of 10 is 5, because 5 is the maximum divisor of 10. And for simplicity, you put p of 1 to be 1. And omega of nu to be the number of distinct prime divisors. So omega of 10 is 2, because 2 and 5 are the only prime divisors of 10. So once you have that, and 1 doesn't have any prime divisor, so omega of 1 is 0. So one simple observation which we can make is the following. You know that product of k consecutive integers is divisible by k factorial. So in other words, every prime less than or equal to k divides k product of k consecutive integers. You can show the same thing. Here, instead of k consecutive integers, if you have product of k consecutive terms of an arithmetic progression, every prime less than k will divide it except for primes which divide d, because I've chosen n and d to be co-prime. So any prime divisor of d1 divide this product, except for those, it will be divisible by all primes less than or equal to k. So therefore, what I can see is that the maximum prime divisor of this product n, n plus d, n plus k minus 1 d will be bigger than the largest prime divisor, largest prime less than or equal to k. So here pi dk, I've defined pi dk is the number of primes less than or equal to k for which p is 4 prime to d. Then p of 1 is 2, p of 2. So pi denotes the ith prime. So p of pi dk is the pi dk prime, and this prime is less than or equal to k. So largest prime we know is actually, I know it's close to k, but it's less than, or I mean, yeah. So largest prime divisor would be bigger than the largest prime up to k. So that's what I'm going to say. But then the question arises is that there are two questions which comes up. Can you find a, so I know that every prime less than k and which is co prime to d divides it. Now, then obviously two problems come up here. Can you find a prime bigger than k which divides the product of k consecutive terms of an arithmetic progression? And another question is that can you find a prime p bigger than k whose exact power divides dividing the product is odd? So that means so for a prime bigger than you want to find a prime bigger than k such that either p or p cube or p power 5, so an odd power exactly divides the product. So now let's start with question two. So basically, okay, so we're asking if you can find, can you find a prime bigger than k for which the largest divisor, the exact power divides, exact power dividing this product of k consecutive terms is odd. Suppose this is not true. Then what happens is that for every prime bigger than k, the exact power of p dividing the product of k consecutive terms is even, so it's 0 mod 2. So then we can, then you can write this product n plus d n plus k minus 1 d in this form. Of course, you can always write in this form b times y square, where b is square free, and y square is, of course, square part you put in y and square free part you put in b. But the fact that all the prime bigger than k, every prime bigger than k divides into an even power means they'll all go to the square part. So the square free part is less than or equal to k. So only the primes less than or equal to k will appear in the square free part of this product. So we want to actually consider this equation. So n plus dn plus k minus 1 b equal to by square. In fact, so while b is 1, you're asking the product being a square. So in case of d, when d is 1, this is nothing but product of k consecutive integers starting at n. So n plus 1, n plus k is by square. So from the earlier work of Erdős, Rigé, then Erdős and Selfridge and Sarda, this is completely known. So we know exactly when it is, we know completely about this solutions of this equation. So we're going to consider d bigger than 1. In fact, there are no solutions except for trivial solutions. So we'll consider d bigger than 1. So when d is bigger than 1, so we're starting with k equal to 4. That means we're asking n plus d, n plus 2 d, n plus 3 d is by square, whether it has a solution. Now, b is a square free number whose largest prime factor is less than or equal to 4. That means square free number composed of primes 2 and 3. So possibilities b is 1, 2, 3, and 6. And one can easily show that when, of course, b is 1, that is Euler's theorem. But when b is 1, 2, and 3, it doesn't have a solution that we can see. And there are infinitely many solutions when b is 6. Actually, I'm going to give you a proof of this statement, which is quite interesting. You rewrite this equation here, which I've highlighted here. So you multiply, you divide it by n power 4, and multiply by 6 square into, this is 4. So you make it square on the right side by multiplying by 6 square into b power 5. b cube. So 6 is, once you divide by n, then n square, then n power 4, then n goes away, 1 plus d by n will come, 1 plus 2 d by n will come, 1 plus 3 d by n will come. Then you multiply 6b in the first part, 3b in the second factor, 2b in the third factor, and you form this equation. So this is the equation. So what I do is that I put x to be 2b plus 6b d by n, and y to be 6b square y by n square. Then you get an equation of the form x square is x times x plus b x plus 4b. So this is an elliptic curve. So elliptic curve is top of genus one. So genus zero. So, yes. Yeah, sorry, yeah, no, okay, yeah, so this is an elliptic curve. We can see that discriminant is negative, discriminant is non-zero, so it's an elliptic curve. And by using magma, we can find that this curve has rank zero when b is 1, 2, and 3, and it has rank 1 when b is 6. Once the rank is zero, means it doesn't, it has only finitely many points, so for which we can check for the solutions. In fact, we can check that torsion points are given by only these points, and from here we can go back to the original equation to see that there are more solutions. So now when b is equal to 6, I don't know if it has only, it has finitely many solutions, so in finitely many solutions, so we have to consider b equal to 6. So to do for b equal to 6, we use a interesting idea due to Runge. So what we do is that we starting with a solution, we construct other solutions. So let me give you the idea here. You start with a solution n naught d naught y naught of this equation. So n naught plus d naught, n naught plus 2 d naught, n naught plus 6 d naught is 6 y square. In fact, as you can see that when n is 1, d equal to 2, it has a solution. So 1, yes. Yeah, yeah. So n is 1, 2, 3. Yeah. So 1, 2, 3, 4. Yeah. So 1 into 2 into 3 into 4. Yeah. It gives a solution. So if you put x naught is n naught by d naught. And so in this, once you write a solution, you put x naught to be n naught by d naught, y naught to be 6 y naught by d naught square. Then you consider this equation. So in fact, from here, you go to this equation, y naught square is 6x, x plus 1, x plus 2, x plus 3. So you multiply by 6 and divide by d power 4. So you have now here x and y are rational numbers, and we're looking for a solution. Now, if you put x to be x plus x naught with x non-zero, then we get a new equation. If you put here, then you get, once you expand it, so then you get g square is a naught times x power 4 plus a 1 times x cube plus a 2 x square plus a 3 x plus a 4. So you get an equation, a polynomial in of degree 4 on the right side, which is a x square. Clearly, when x is 0 and z is y naught, is a solution of 2 from the previous information. And here, the constant term n naught is nothing but y naught square. This we need to see, remember. So now I'm going to take n, b. I'm going to choose n being given by this equation, 2y naught a plus b square is a2, and 2y naught b is a3. Because a2, remember that this a1, a2, a3, this comes from this x naught. Yeah, depending on x naught is appearing. So you start with some x naught, then you get n naught, a1, a2, a3, and a4 is y naught square. So you solve for AB given by this. From here, actually, if you take AB given by these equations, then one can check easily that A1 minus 2AB by A square minus A naught, and Z is AX square plus BX plus Y naught is the solution. Basically, you complete the squares and find that these are the solutions of this equation. Yeah, so once you get this solution, then you see that x plus x naught, which is a1 minus 2ab by a square minus a naught plus x naught, is a new value of x satisfying this original this earlier equation y square is equal to 6x into x plus 1 to x plus 2 x plus 3. So basically, from a given solution, you are x not y not, you are getting another solution. So you are getting one solution. You are getting another solution. This is given by x plus x naught. And again, from here, you get back, you come to another solution of the equation n plus t, n plus 2d, n plus 3d, 6y square. So applying this process, so we'll apply this process again and again. So you start with n is equal to 1, d is equal to 1, and y is equal to 2. You get a solution of this above equation with n equal to 1, d equal to 1, and y equal to 2. So by following the above process, you get another solution. N is 676, d is 9071, y is 2400691. So basically, starting at 112, you get one solution. Now you start at this solution, then you will get another solution. So it will keep on increasing. So that's how one finds that there are infinitely many solutions of this equation. N plus d, n plus 2d, n plus 3d, equal to 6y squared. So this is a way so this proves that there are infinitely many solutions here. So when k is 4, when you have a product of 4 terms, it's well understood now. So obviously now what we want to look at is that what happens when k is bigger than or equal to 5. So it's a conjecture, stronger conjecture of Eder's. It's not by Eder's, but I'm going to tell you the conjecture of Eder's too. So it's a conjecture from the earlier results that by looking at this conjecture of Eder's and research work by different authors that this is the conjecture which is made. That means if you take a product of 5 or more consecutive terms of an arithmetic progression, it cannot be square, of course, but not only square, it cannot be some almost a square in the sense that the square free part less than or equal to k is not possible. So this is the conjecture one. So PB, remember that PB means the largest prime divisor of B. So now regarding this, so in a joint work with Hirata Kono, Soret, and Tideman, we actually verified this conjecture for all k from 5 to 100. So that above conjecture with when k is between 5 and 100, this is not possible. In fact, here, when k equal to 6 was also done independently by Bennett, Bruin, Giori, and Haidu. And a case k equal to 6 was also done independently by Savok Stengel. It was actually proved by Savok Stengel. This is what we know so far on this conjecture. Basically, up to 100 terms, it cannot be a perfect square. Not only perfect square, it cannot be almost a perfect square. So another result on this direction was given by in a joint work with Sore, where we saw that if this equation implies that D has to be quite large. So D has to be bigger than maximum of 10 power 10 and k power log log k. That means, when k is quite big, D has to be also quite big. So in fact, we also saw that when D is less than 10 power 10, there are no solutions. So for any n and k or b and y, so there are no solutions when D is less than 10 power 10. And another reason which we proved that time was that if you have D, D up to 10 power 10, of course, it has no solution. But if you have D, say, suppose a prime power product of two prime powers, product of three prime powers, or product of two four prime distinct prime powers, then it cannot have a solution. So this is, this was also another reason. This was proved along with Soré. Of course, when D was a prime power, this was also proved by Soré. This was first proved by Soré and Sarita. So now I come to this conjecture of Eder's, which is a weaker version of the original conjectures. Original the conjecture says that product of five or more consecutive terms of an arithmetic progression is not a perfect sphere. Now Eder's gave a weaker version of this conjecture, which says that so I don't want to say five or more, but can you find a constant such that when k is larger than that constant, there are no solutions. So this conjecture is Eder's conjecture. Equation one with that n plus d n plus k minus 1 d is by square implies that k is bounded by a computable absolute constant. So this is still open, though we know some results on this direction. An ABC conjecture implies this Eder's conjecture. So this is an idea due to Granville. A proof of this result was given in my master's thesis, and this also appeared in a joint paper with Soré. And in the print form, it was appeared in JCN team. There's a typo here. 2016 in 2016 it was appeared in JCN. So this is the well-known ABC conjecture due to Osterle and Masser. So it states that for any given epsilon positive, you have a computable constant kappa epsilon, which depends only on epsilon, such that whenever you have co-prime positive integers ABC with A plus B, C, then C has to be bounded by this constant times the radical of ABC. So this product of prime dividing ABC, this is the radical of ABC. So this is of course a well-known open problem. It's quite considered quite difficult. In fact, it implies an asymptotic version of Fermat's last theorem. So this gives almost one line proof of Fermat's last theorem. So what we actually used in the proof that ABC conjecture implies this result, which requires quite a bit of work, is that result an equivalent version of the ABC conjecture due to Granville and Tucker. Also, the idea is due to Noam Elkies. So basically, it connects these prime divisors of polynomial at polynomial value. So let fxy be homogeneous polynomial. Suppose f has pairwise non-proportional linear factors in its factorization over C. Then given epsilon, we can find a constant which depend only on f and epsilon, such that if m and n are co-prime integers, then the product of primes dividing fmn will be bounded below by this constant times maximum of mn to the power degree of f minus 2 minus epsilon. So this is a little bit technical compared to the original ABC conjecture, but these are equivalent results. So this implies addition, ABC implies this. So by using this conjecture, only with the Eder's conjecture is proved. Now I want to go to some partial results on the Eder's conjecture. So Soré and Tiedemann, they proved that the Eder's conjecture tells you that this equation n plus t n plus k minus 1 d equal to by square implies k is bounded by an absolute constant. So this is of course open. What Soré and Tiedemann prove is that they saw that k is bounded by some constant which depends on omega d, where omega d is the number of distinct prime divisors of d. So they gave a bound which was not explicit. So an explicit version was given by me in 2007, where we saw that k is bounded by 2 times omega d times 2 power omega d. So basically, this equation implies k is bounded by this number. So in particular, if you know the number of distinct prime divisor of d, then you can bound k. So the yeah, so that's all. So if you fix D, not only the fixed prime divisor of D, you can bound it by this. Now, one can also like, if you're, yeah, so if you fix D, then, yeah, if you fix D, then it becomes a polynomial. And you can use Faltings theorem, then K is bounded. So for a fixed K, then it becomes a polynomial. Then you can use Faltings theorem to show, say that there are only finitely many solutions. So I mean, not only that you can bound n, but the Faltings theorem is not effective in the sense that not all explicit. We don't know how to get a bound completely. I mean, explicit bound. So the question is that can we make it explicit? So regarding this, I get the following results. So what I saw is that if n is like, so if n is bigger than k squared times, like if you fix d, I mean, right now I'm not fixing anything, but this result is quite useful when you fix d. So if n is bigger than k squared d squared by 40,000 minus kd, then this equation has no solutions. In other words, what I want to says that if n is bigger than n plus kd is bigger than k squared d squared by 40,000, then this product has a prime divisor bigger than k to n odd power, of which divides c to n odd power. So then what we can see is that this theorem implies that if d is fixed, then you can bound this all n and k explicitly. So what we know is that for a d fixed, omega d is fixed, then k is bounded by this 2 omega d, 2 power omega d. Then n will be also bounded by k squared d squared with 40,000 minus kd. So you can bound k and n. So in theory, for a fixed d, you can actually solve it completely. So this is a first result in the direction where you can, I mean, if you fix one variable, all others can fix explicitly. So, and also I have a result where which connects these prime divisors of this product with this equation. So, this is the condition. So, if you, yeah, so I assume that, okay, if n is bigger than k squared d squared by 40,000 minus kd, then there are no solutions. So what happens if, and so can we drop this condition? So we can drop this condition provided you can have, provided they say, I mean, if this product n plus d, n plus k minus 1, d has large prime factors. So this is the conjecture. So let m and d be coprime and m is bigger than or equal to dk. Then what we, yeah, so the conjecture tells you that largest prime divisor of m plus d, m plus k minus 1, d is bigger than dk by 200. Yeah, so this is the conjecture. In fact, so if, what I'm going to show is that this conjecture implies that the Eder's conjecture is actually true. It implies the Eder's conjecture. Now, in fact, not only the Eder's conjecture, it implies that the conjecture one, in the sense that this product of k consecutive terms of an arithmetic progression is never a perfect square. So this is of course open, and this is true for d less than 400. So this is one can see that this is actually true for d less than 400, and also it has some consequences in some other settings. So now I want to just go to this. The largest prime, what do we know about this largest prime divisors of product of k consecutive integers? So it's an old result of Sylvester that if you have a product of k consecutive terms of an arithmetic progression is bigger than k if n is bigger than or equal to d plus k. And yeah, so of course, there are a lot of generalizations. When d is equal to 1, we're asking, this product of k consecutive terms m plus d, m plus 2d, m plus k minus 1d is bigger than sk, for m bigger than k bigger than 2. So what are values, I mean, what values of s we can get it? So regarding this Sorin-Tiedemann, so that when s is bigger than 1 for d bigger than 1. So basically, product of k, three or more consecutive terms of an arithmetic progression has a prime divisor bigger than k, unless ndk is 273. And this was sharpened to this 2k for, yes. So basically, so with in a joint work with Sore, where we saw that if you take product of k consecutive terms of arithmetic progression, it has a prime divisor bigger than 2k, except for finitely many triplets, MDK. So, and we're asking for k by 200. So in that way, this conjecture 5 was, I mean, it's true for d less than 400. Now, what I want to show is that the conjecture, so this conjecture implies that this equation nn plus tn plus k minus 1 d equal to dy square has no solution. So this is what I want to show it now. So basically, once you have, you know that this product of distinct terms of consecutive terms of a arithmetic progression has last prime divisors, then then for any arithmetic progression, arithmetic progression won't have any, so I mean, it won't be a square. So that's the result. So now assume that conjecture 5 is true. That means largest prime divisor of of k consecutive terms with k bigger than dk is bigger than dk by 200. Now taking m is n plus the least integer function of k by 2 times d, then I see that the conjecture says tells you that m plus d up to m plus d up to m plus k minus 2 minus 1 d. So this is a product of the k by 2 terms is bigger than d times k minus k by 2, which is bigger than d times k minus 1 by 400. So this is what we have. And this is true since m is bigger than k by 2. Since m is n plus k by 2 d, that means m is bigger than k by 2 d, which is bigger than k by k minus 2. So I use this conjecture 2 times. So that means largest prime factor is bigger than d times k minus 1 by 400. And what I know is that this equation has solution means there's a prime divisor bigger than k to square. And that prime is actually, so largest prime divisor is bigger than dk minus 1 by 400. So largest prime divisor is of this product is bigger than dk minus 1 by 400. And it divides to a, and it comes in the even power. So the largest term n plus k minus 1 d should be bigger than the square of this number, d times k minus 1 by 400. So this is what I think. So n plus k minus 1 d will be bigger than the largest square of the largest prime divisor, which is bigger than this number. Or what you are getting is that n is bigger than d square times k minus 1 square by 1,60,000 minus dk. And this is definitely bigger than dk since d is bigger than 10 power 10 and k is bigger than 100. So this is, I'm using the fact that d is bigger than 10 power 10 and k is bigger than 100. So now once this n is bigger than dk, I can use this conjecture 5 again. So this product of k consecutive terms has a prime divisor bigger than dk by 200. And the largest prime divisor, the square of the largest prime divisor will divide the product. So in particular, largest term n plus k minus 1 b should be bigger than dk by 200 whole square. So that means n plus k minus 1, d should be bigger than d square k square by 40,000. So, and now the assertion follows from theorem 3. So this is the theorem 6. If n is bigger than n plus k, d is bigger than n k square d square by 40,000, then this equation has no solutions. So this is how we prove that the conjecture on the largest prime divisor of k consecutive terms implies the error conjecture. So the but proof of theorem 6 is actually quite involved. So I don't think I will be able to give a proof here. So what I want to tell you is that in the proof, we actually use quite a lot of arguments. In fact, we use quadratic reciprocity arguments, estimates from prime number theory, a lot of combinatorial arguments, Becker's theorem of linear forms in logarithms, and solving simultaneous PLS equations, and also solving some of the Diophantine equations, and computing rank and torsion points of elliptic curves. So we use quite a bit of this result. So I won't go into proof of theorem 6. Now, in the remaining part of this, in the next few minutes, I want to talk. I want to talk to you about the second problem. Yeah, so maybe it's a good time if someone has a question on the on this, then I'll go to the next part. Okay, so maybe I'll continue. So now I have to go to the next question, which is given an arithmetic progression of, here actually n plus one term. So you look at a plus q, a plus 2q, a plus qn. And you're asking how many squares are there? So of course, what I know is that so we want to count the number of squares. Now let me give you some definition. So for this arithmetic progression, let us denote by Q and QA. So that means arithmetic progression of length n plus one is starting at A and common difference Q. So this denotes the number of squares in this arithmetic progression. And let QN means the maximum of the number of squares run of which we are maximum of this number of squares for every arithmetic progression A plus Qn. So basically for any A and Q, you compute Q and Q a number of squares in this arithmetic progression of length N plus one and take the maximum for a maximum. So we call it Qn. Now I have to recall Fermat's result. So remember that Fermat's result states that you cannot have four squares in an arithmetic progression. So definitely by dividing this length n into four parts, every part will have at most three squares. So we'll have at most three n by four squares in this sequence. So for any AQ, we'll have at most three n by four squares. But this is a very trivial bound, very crude bound. So we have to ask, can you make it better? So regarding this, there's a conjecture of Erdős, Erdős' conjecture, there's a conjecture that number of squares in an arithmetic progression of length n will be of the small o of n. That means qn by n goes to actually zero. There's a typo here. So zero when n goes to infinity. It's one should be replaced by zero. So this was proved by Semeradi in 1975. In fact, he proved this in relation to his well-known result on the existence of three-term arithmetic progressions in a given set. So this is on the conjecture of Erdős. After this conjecture of Erdős, proved by Semeradi, there has been other improvements. So there's a result of Bomberry, Granville, and Pins in around 2000, in the last, I think 2013, I think, yeah, if I remember early. They said the number of number of squares up to n time arithmetic progression is bounded, is of the order of n to the power 2/3 plus some constant of 1. And Bomberi and Janier, so they actually improved this result again to this order, to the order of n to the power 3/5. So now, what is the expected bound? So that's what we expect, Now there's this conjecture of Grudin, conjecture states that you can expect up to around square root of n squares in an arithmetic progression of length n. And there's a strong Grudin's conjecture, which that in fact, the maximum number of squares occurs when A is 1 and Q is 24. And so that means 1 plus 24, 1 plus 24 square, and 1 plus 2 into 24, 1 plus 3 into 24, etc. So in this arithmetic progression given by A equal to 1, Q equal to 24. And so this is square root of n by 3 n plus of 1. So this is for n bigger than or equal to 6. So this is the strong Grudin's conjecture. Because these are open problems. Right now we don't know. So regarding this, there's some work which I will tell you. So you can observe that the arithmetic progression, this 1 plus 24. So up to 6 term, there are 5 squares. So 1 is a square, 1 plus 24 is a square, 1 plus 2 into 24 is a square. 1 plus 3 into 24 is not a square. 1 plus 4 into 24 is, so this is not a square, but 1 plus 5, 24 is a square. So up to 6, therefore, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. Up to 5, there are 3 squares. And when, if you take A is 49, Q is 120, then up to the first 5 times give 4 squares. So 49 is 7 square. 49 plus 120 is 13 square. 49 plus 2 into 120 is 17 square. And 49, so this is not a square. Then 49 plus 4 is 23 square. So in the first 5 terms, there are 4 squares for this arithmetic progression. But for 24, it's actually 3. So, and we know that by Fermat's result, you cannot have 4 squares in arithmetic progression. So up to 5 terms, there are at most 4 squares. That's why Q5 is 4, and it occurs for this particular arithmetic progressions. Now, by the way, here in this sequence of arithmetic progression, terms of arithmetic progression, 409 was the only number with which is not a square. So there's a result of Gonzalez, Jimenez, and Charles, who saw that, in fact, the Q square root of 409 is the only quadratic field. So then let's look at the arithmetic progression of in a quadratic field. So they saw that actually this Q square root 409 is the only quadratic field. We have 5 squares in arithmetic progression, which are actually given by this arithmetic progression. So the conjecture is that when n is bigger than or equal to 6, the above arithmetic progression 1, 1 plus 24, 1 plus 24, this dominates when we count the number of squares. And regarding the Grudin's conjecture, so this Gonzalez, Jimenez, and Sales, they proved that in fact the largest the maximum squares occur for in that arithmetic progression, 1 plus 24 1 plus 24, when n lies between 6 and 52. So they verify this conjecture of a strong Grudin conjecture for n up to 52. So recently, I was looking at this problem, in his joint work with Pranavesh Das, who was my former student. So we got some partial results, but of course, it's still some way to go for towards the proof of the conjecture. So we actually saw some interesting observations, and so what we can say is that we can connect it to the number of distance between the squares for a given Q. If you count the number, if you look at all the squares modulo Q and look at some distance, we can connect it. So in particular, so let me give you this in a bit more precise way. So I can assume that to solve this Rudin's conjecture, we can assume that the first term is itself is a square, and Q is odd or F divides Q. And for a given A and Q, take Q naught to be Q if Q is odd, and Q naught to be Q by 2 if A divides Q. I know that Q is divisible by A if it's even. Now you look at the solutions of this congruence X square is equal to, is congruent to A square mod Q naught. They're exactly 2 power omega Q naught. Omega means the number of distinct prime divisors. So 2 power omega Q naught solutions, which I denoted by this A1, A2 up to A times 2, A times 2 power omega Q naught, which lies between 1 and Q naught. And one can easily observe that AI plus A2 omega Q naught plus 1 minus I is actually Q naught. And this is a simple observation. So they're exactly 2 power omega Q naught solutions of this quadratic congruence. Then we could actually show that Rudin conjecture is equivalent to showing that the difference between the squares of this, that solutions AI square minus AJ square times 2 by Q, if we can show that for this is bigger than I minus J square, whenever I minus J is bigger than equal to 6, then Rudin's conjecture, it implies Rudin's conjecture. And in fact, we also could show that, there's a little typo here. If you fix the number of distinct prime divisors of this common difference Q, we could prove, Rudin's conjecture, Rudin's conjecture in the sense that if Q is composed of up to 5 prime divisors, then number of squares in the n term is actually bounded by the number of squares with the common difference 24. So this is what we could prove. And in fact, what we could actually say is that for a given odd Q, or Q is an even number with 24 not dividing Q, then I'm having one more typo. This is correct. So if you take this number of squares in n term arithmetic progression, this is bounded by number of terms squares with common difference 24. When Q is odd or Q is even, but 24 doesn't divide Q. So now from this, a strong Rudin conjecture is now equivalent to proving that for every multiple of 24, number of squares is actually bounded by number of squares in arithmetic progression with common difference 24 and first term 1. So that's all for now. Thank you for your attention.
Yeah. Any questions from the speaker?
Thank you.
Thank you.
Okay, thank you.
Yeah, very nice.
Talk. There's some queries. Yes. I think Joe Mark has a comment. Yeah, that's true. Actually, I should take here. And Yeah, so a plus q n minus 1 also that I can just.
Okay, so if there are no further questions, we can just stop the live stream.